Hi, from our mission trip to Mexico, and myself and Phil Starr and Mustoff family, John, Susan, and their sons David and Andrew came down with us, as well as former director of Christian education here, Joyce Schrader, who now is a pastor in South Amherst, and her husband Steve. We all went down to Tijuana and worked in a home building project. And so we want to thank those of you who prayed for us this week past and prayed for our work. We had a busy week every day working, but then at night we were able to go out and look at some of the things that we needed to see, which included a migrant center where people who are recently deported from the United States go to have a place to stay and reassess their life and make contact with family members who sometimes don't even know that they have been deported. We also went to a children's home, and we went this time also to a home for disabled children, both developmentally and physically, where a priest kind of manufactures his own prosthetics and has a community where people care for one another, and parents can come and be a part of that community as they raise their children. So we saw a lot of good things, and I'm sure in the weeks ahead we'll be talking about some of those, but we want to thank you for that. And so it's ironic that today our passage is Exodus 17, because Exodus 17 is about an important spiritual theme, and that is the Exodus. And in Judaism, the first five books of the Bible are the Torah. And if any of you have been to a Jewish temple, you'll know that they separate the Torah from all of the other writings because they are the center of who they are. And the center of who they are is to recognize that they were once foreigners, that they were in a position where they needed help, and God guided them through the wilderness into the promised land. Now, what I want to say about that is two things. Number one is that we do need to understand this spiritually, because you have experienced Exodus in your life. You've experienced times when you've been uprooted. You've experienced times when you had loss. And that loss is so great that you feel like you're in a different world now. However that loss may have occurred, or whatever that loss might have been, many times we're thrust out into the wilderness and we have to look like different. We also today need to realize that our scripture is central to the way the people of Israel look at life in general. And that is that we can't forget that this is a text about refugees. It's a text about how we're to care for people in this world who are vulnerable. And finally, what I want to say about this is, we don't just have the word refugee. We have the word refuge. And I want you to consider the people and the places that have been a refuge for you, and how you made it through your own personal exodus. Because it's only by our understanding our own vulnerabilities and our own Exodus experiences that we can have others who are in a similar situation, who are in their own Exodus. Those people are many in the world today. So really what I want you to know is that this idea of Exodus and this idea of being a refugee is really the foundation of what Lent is all about. And that's why we have it in our lectionary. It's the 40 days that Jesus was in the wilderness being tested and remembering where his source of strength came from. And so these 40 days of Lent are a way for us to remember our own testing and our own wilderness journey, and to remember where it is that we can find refuge in this life. And that's an essential thing. It's essential for us to be safe. It's essential for us to be surrounded by people who are a refuge. And I hope that as we talk about how it might be that you can be a refuge for someone who's suffering through a wilderness. Scripture again and again tells us that we are to welcome and to remember the stranger. I always want to remind you during Lent, I try to say this every Sunday, that the purpose of Lent is to struggle against everything that leads us away from the love of God and neighbor. So during the Exodus, Moses had some leadership, and in our story today, people were thirsty. So he takes his staff. Moses had a staff, much like I have my log, for the children's moments. And he struck a rock with it, and water came out. Because people were complaining. And so, as a good biblical historical figure would do, you name the place after the thing that happened there. So it's named Massah and Meribah, which means testing and quarreling. Now we all know that when we face stress in our life, we also face tests, and we face quarreling, and we face complaining. And I once enjoyed a sermon by a rabbi friend who I don't remember a whole lot else in it, except he was talking about this passage, and he said, there's complaining, and then there's complaining. And we all know how that is on our road trips with our family, isn't that right? We don't have the comforts of home and the things that we always wanted. We complain. Are we there yet? What are we going to eat? You have to begin thinking about some of these basics of life when the things you would normally depend on, your normal refuge of your bedroom or your electronics, are not there anymore. You begin very quickly to think differently. So in the wilderness, it's a time of testing. It's said that the 12 tribes of Israel each had 12,000 people as they left Egypt out of slavery. Now, if my math is correct, that's 144,000 people. Now, that's a very large group of people for Moses to be hauling through the desert without any resources. And it says that as the people of Israel went on, they didn't turn people away, but they brought other people along in the journey because they recognized how important it was for them to form a caring community and not to close themselves off from others. They brought people along. So I want to read you a few pieces of scripture from about refugees. Genesis 12. Now there was a famine in the land, and so Abram went down to Egypt to reside there as an alien, for the famine was severe in the land. So in the very beginning of the history of Israel, Abraham was a foreigner. Genesis 46. Jacob moves his family to Egypt to escape the famine and reunite with Joseph. Joseph brings his brothers to Pharaoh, and they are welcomed and they are given jobs. Exodus 1. Joseph's generation is gone, and the Egyptians begin to oppress the Israelites. Therefore, they set taskmasters over them to oppress them with forced labor. Exodus 12. The Israelites were driven out of Egypt so fast that they didn't have time to make provisions, and they had to make unleavened cakes of bread. We have that today. When we celebrate communion, sometimes we celebrate with unleavened bread. We have a Seder meal where you have to celebrate with unleavened bread so you remember what it's like to be a refugee. Exodus 22, Moses gives the people a law from God. You shall not wrong or oppress a resident alien, for you were aliens in the land of Egypt. Numbers 35 and Joshua 20 repeat themselves. The Lord instructs Moses to give cities of refuge to the Levites so that when the Israelites must flee into Canaan, they will have cities of refuge available to them. Deuteronomy 1:16. Give the members of your community a fair hearing and judge rightly between one person and another, whether they are a citizen or a resident alien. This is Torah. This is the law for people in Judaism. Deuteronomy 10. For the Lord your God loves the strangers, providing them food and clothing. You shall also love the stranger, for you were strangers in the land of Egypt. Deuteronomy 14 and 26. It appears as though the process of tithing was begun in part to support resident aliens. Psalm 105, these are songs that you sing. This is like We Shall Overcome or something. Psalm 105, remembering their journey, when they were few in number, of little account, and strangers in the world, wandering from nation to nation, from one kingdom to another people. Psalm 146, the Lord watches over the foreigner. Everybody pick this up, all the prophets of the Old Testament. Jeremiah, do no wrong or no violence to the alien. Zechariah, do not oppress the alien. Malachi, the messenger will bear witness against those who thrust aside the alien. Matthew, the second chapter, Jesus and his parents escape Herod, and they flee to Egypt so that nothing happens to Jesus. Matthew 25, the great sheep and the goats, I was a stranger and you welcomed me. Romans 12, Paul, the mark of the true Christian is to extend hospitality to strangers. In Hebrews, finally, it says, show hospitality to strangers, for by doing that, some have entertained angels unawares. And I only read about a tenth of the passages that you can find in the Bible. Again and again, the people of Israel wanted to remember that Exodus experience so that they would be a refuge for people who are refugees. Now we have a wonderful opportunity. I also want to throw out. I have commercials embedded in the message today. Now the first commercial is this. That many of you enjoy when we have a Seder on Maundy Thursday. Because it's a way for us to remember our Jewish roots, right? It's a way for us to remember the Passover and everything that it meant for Jesus to live and die and gather disciples and be resurrected in the world. And all those things that go along with this theme of Exodus, right? Jesus was a foreigner and a stranger in this world. He was nailed to the cross. He was raised into the world that ought to be. All these things are tied together in that Passover meal. The liberation of slavery from Egypt. Being rescued. Finding a refuge. All those great thoughts are tied up in the Seder meal. It's the hope that one day we will live in a world where there's justice. One day we'll live in a world where people create caring community. And we're the ones who are called to create that caring community, no matter how desperate the situation or the world might appear. We're the one to strike with the bride, a place where it looks like there is no caring, and bring forth water for those who want water. So here's a commercial. We always have a little bit of difficulty of attention as a Christian guy performing a Seder. Okay? Now it is material that I got from my rabbi friend. I got it, okay? But I'm sure that I miss a lot, and I don't understand a lot because it's not my culture, right? So we reenact the Seder together. But now I've discovered that the College of Worcester is offering the genuine Seder celebration on Tuesday of Holy Week, and it is $14 for the whole meal, the whole service and celebration of Passover, and it's going to be in Kittredge Hall, and I'll have some information for you if you would like to go to an actual Seder celebration, but I can guarantee you that they're going to lift up the cup, and they're going to say next year we'll be in Jerusalem. Next year, we'll find recognition. Next year, things will be different. See, I also promised you that I would use Martin Luther King's thing about transformation during Lent, right? Every sermon, I got to work this in. Martin Luther King said, you prepare your minds, you prepare your hearts, and you prepare your calendars, your schedule, right? Martin Luther King said that. We don't hear that very often. That might be the most important thing King said, is to prepare your life to be a refuge. Prepare your life to find refuge in this world. So, what do the people of Israel say when they're in the wilderness? Is the Lord among us or not? What's the answer to that? Of course the Lord is with us, right? Of course the Lord is with us. We try to do the right thing. We try to create that community and that kingdom that Jesus talked about. So I want to ask you this. This is the second, okay? I got three phases here. The second phase is I want to talk about the two arrows. The two arrows of suffering, okay? And this is a pretty ancient philosophy. It goes way back to ancient thought. It's suffering in general, okay? There's a bad thing that happens to you. And, you know, it's almost certain that most of the bad things that happen to us in life happen through no fault of our own. They're just random bad things that happen to us, and we all are subject to the suffering of our physical body. We're subject to the suffering of the systems that are around us, and we really have no control over them. So the first arrow is just suffering. And the thing that I want to say about that is I want to give you an illustration. So, how many of you, you get up in the middle of the night, you need to go get a drink or can't sleep or something, and it's dark, and you stub your toe? All right, how many people have that ever have to? Okay. So that happens. It's a bad thing, right? Through no fault of their own. What's the first thing you think? You think, who moved that chair? Who put that chair there? That's the second dart, okay? Now, the first dart's bad enough. You say, okay, stub my toe, and then you go on, right? But that's not the way our brains think, because we have a negativity bias, and it takes five positive experiences to balance out one bad one. That's just the way we are. That's the way our minds work. So we say, man, I wish my husband hadn't moved that chair. Right? Right? And why can't I have a nightlight at night? Right? You guys have those discussions? Thank you, darkness. So what happens when you do those things is that it escalates, right? It's not just the bad thing that happens. It's the bad thing that you think about someone else when that happens. That's what's happening to Moses in our passage here today, right? There's a bad thing that happens. I'm thirsty. Moses, it's all your fault. We have to have a reason sometimes. We make up a reason. I was talking to a guy. We had two other colleges there while we were there. We had University of Massachusetts from Boston, and we had USC. So I was talking to the chaplain from USC, and he said they had a dispute on a work site because they were digging it. We have to dig these terribly deep trenches in Mexico, put the block down in because the houses have to be earthquake proof, and it's, you know, probably about 6 feet, something like that. But you have to dig straight down. What so happens that one of the digging crews from USC had sandy soil, and the other digging crew had bedrock. Okay. So what do you think happened? So the people that were digging through the sand said, what's the matter with you guys? You know, our trench is almost done. And they're going, I don't know, man, this is hard. That's the way it is, isn't it? That we expect that everybody's got a level playing field, but that's not the case. There are some sandy soil. And there are other houses in line, the guy hands us the shovels and go over there and it's bedrock. So how can we throw the second dart? How can we say, I made it, why can't they? Because we can't make those judgments. Because that's not the way the world is. That's not the way life is. That's not the way work is. We all know that. So we have this idea of welcoming the stranger because we can't assume the experience of another person. But we have to break the chain of suffering right at the first dart, right? Some bad things happens to you, and all of a sudden everybody wants to give you a solution and tell you why that bad thing happened to you. And so most of the time it says it has nothing to do with you. So that's why I say that people have a right to goodwill from us. Because we never know their experience, and we never know the obstacles that they've had in their life. And that so often we can draw the wrong conclusions about why bad things happen to them. I guess there's a lot of reasons for that. I think one of them is that we want to create a safe world where we believe that all we have to do is the right thing and everything will work out for us. But there are an awful lot of people in this world who try to do the right thing and it doesn't work out very well for them because of the circumstances. So we can't judge those things. So the thing that I want you to consider today, too, is not just that spiritual angle, which is pretty tough. That's tough enough. But I want you today to really think about how difficult it is to be a refugee. It's just terrible. One of the things that we saw while we were there was a refugee camp. You might think there are refugee camps in Tijuana. There are. And it's mainly Haitians. Now, we had an opportunity to talk to some of these folks who were in this refugee camp. And it was just down a little hill from where we were working. So naturally, we were curious and wanted to see what the situation was. And all day long, they can't leave this, you know, maybe city block area. They have these poles that are built up with kind of like a white tarp over them. And there's 60 people that every day they sleep here. And all they do is go out with brooms and they sweep the stoop, keep the area clean because they can't work. They don't have the right to work in Mexico yet. They're working on it. So what happened in Haiti? Earthquake. A lot of people evacuated Haiti during an earthquake. So your country has an earthquake. So you go somewhere else for opportunity. Some of you may have heard about the Brazil Olympics, where primarily they counted on Haitian labor. So these people left because of an earthquake, and then they went to Brazil to work on the Olympics, and then that didn't work out, and they had to make their way up to Mexico. And then they were in a special class of people for a while that were allowed refuge in the United States because of all those circumstances. By the time half of them got up to Tijuana to cross over, the United States changed the circumstances whereby you could come into the United States as a Haitian. So some of the people that we talked to, the one guy had a wife and kids that had crossed over before the rules changed, and he was stuck down there. So these are the kinds of things that happen to people who are refugees in these refugee camps. It's not a good thing, and he's trying to do the right thing, trying to keep his family together, trying to do the good thing. So there have been 3,500 Haitian refugees that have come into California before things changed. And there are at least 1,000 more of our refugees in refugee camps right now in Tijuana. And they claim there are more who are making their way up to Central America because they can't stay down there. So we can say, well, you know, people are going for economic opportunity, but that's not the whole story. The good part about it, this is my second commercial embedded in the sermon, is that a great thing is that we've because we're a global mission church, we started a relationship with a church resettle some refugees that have come to Borken in Germany. So who is a refuge for people, and where do they find it? The family that we worked on a house with, Arturo and Luce, they lived in the Washington state of Washington, and he outdated his work permit, stayed in the States, was deported. She's a U.S. citizen. Their two daughters were born in Washington. And so he's down in Mexico. So he called and he said, I understand, you don't need to come down here. And it's the way it is. And she said, no, we're a family. We're going to come down. So his wife and two daughters came down to be with their father in Tijuana. And that's the house we built. There's another situation that we can see that people are refugees in this world. Who's going to give them refuge? Refugees in the world today, there are more refugees in the world today than since the end of World War II. And in fact, the UN claims that there are 50 million refugees in the world. That's a lot more than the people of Israel going through the refugees. We're showing a movie next Sunday, and that movie will indicate that many people are refugees because of drought, because of climate change. And they were farmers, and they farmed the land, and now the farm's no longer fertile. And they're trying to move to a place where they can continue to make a living as farmers. War, the economy, earthquakes, predatory persecution in some places. They have no place to take refuge. When you're a refugee, you are an outsider in every group, and there is no one to protect you. And the story of these Haitian refugees is a typical story of how people become refugees in a world that they have no control over. So now I want to ask you about the personal aspect of that. When you've been a refugee, when you've been in a place where your world is different, who's been a refuge for you? Well, for the people of Israel, they ask that question. Is the Lord among us or not? And there's an old religious teaching that says we take refuge in God. Sometimes we take refuge in the teachings. Sometimes we take refuge in a community. And one of the best things that we can do is to create a caring community on this earth. We get the word pilgrim. We're pilgrims in this world. It's a popular theme in our songs today. We're all soldiers. One thing that we find when we go down to Mexico is a sense of community. And when we work, everyone from the neighborhood will come around and they want to help. They want to help carry buckets of cement, or they want to make food for the workers or something. They have a very strong sense of community. And we have to be careful in our own country not to lose that sense of community. That sense of saying that we have a commitment to take care of one another and to take care of the common good. That we have a commitment to create caring community here. Because for some time now, that value has been slighted, because we believe and we make laws that say that everyone needs to look out for themselves. Exodus is a human experience, and we all know it pretty well. Exodus is a personal experience, changing jobs, divorce, loss, barren lands. So where will you find refuge? In God's grace, in Jesus, in community? You need to know where to find it in your times of need. And also, we ought to look at ourselves as people who follow Jesus, as a refuge for people who need us in those moments when they are in need. And for us to be that refuge for someone who needs it. So today I want to remind you that our entire religion is based on Exodus. It's based on our wilderness experiences. It's built on our awareness that we need to create a caring community and a place where people are welcome. So today, as we offer our prayers and our gifts up to God, we remember that we're doing more than sustaining what is. We're trying to have a vision of how the world it ought to be as pilgrims and sojourners on this earth. Amen.